enter this guy.
And so, I mean, I've never seen anything like it. I'll show them to you tomorrow. Vaping all good. Yeah, that's good. Yeah, very good. Yeah, good. So we don't try not to do good here, Adam. Good's the enemy of great, mate. But he's all, oh, it's good. Yeah. And he's getting all the camera people to, like, compete with each other. Oh, Mark, you have to get an Eric. Oh, you completely outpaced him, mate. But no, he's brilliant. He's really good. You okay? Should I put my ears in and just check if we're on air? One of the opening shots is me sitting there. Just again, I wouldn't have noticed it, but it's just the way it looks in the shot, the rhythm of it. What's that? Yeah. Hi. And he chooses when to be deaf. That's the other thing. He's like, I can't hear you, mate. Like, as soon as you have a problem, he can't hear you. Oh, you got that, yeah. Well, it's great to mythologize the theater, too. You know, if you think about it, I'm trying to make one of the great, not just a little concert film, but it's something that might last. So it's just worth the trouble. I'm sure everyone's worn out here, but please tell everyone thank you.
My size increased, and now I'm 14 stories high. Because I'm a dog.
train lays down a rhythm track, keeps its own time, slowing and speeding until the Welsh-accented towns and valleys give way to the cheers and jeers of the English countryside, which eventually disgorges, and we descend into the underworld and underground of London. Here in the tile tunnels, the drumbeat crescendos in volume until we are spat out into a station platform in Paddington, where we make our way to the circus that was Piccadilly. This is it, Orpheus in the underworld, with a cassette player instead of a lyre. Orpheus and his lover, Eurydice. But it's not the beguiling Eurydice who will need saving. It's Orpheus himself. She's here to save his life because she knows if he doesn't become who he is here, he will never have one. This is the story of how Eurydice saved Orpheus from his own hell. The story of how Alison Stewart saved me from myself. See, the less you know, the less you find out as you grow. I knew much more then than I do now. Neon hot day glow eyes, city lit by fireflies. They were advertising in the skies for people like us. You're not around. I get ready to leave the ground. Blessings not just for the ones who kneel. Luckily, 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 lucky me. In the company of Jack Nafley, Kate Ellis, Gemma Doherty. Lucky me, lucky me. Lucky we, lucky we, lucky we. Hola. Bonsoir. Hello. Welcome to my Quarterman show. Might I say this feels somewhat transgressivo to meet you here without my bandmates. I told them it was one night only, a literary event, not a blow-by-blow or a magic show in a West Side gospel tent. The trick is here, we disappear into each other's lives. A somersault, a leap, a vault, some pratfalls, stage dives. New York City, 74th and Broadway. Let the beacon light our way. Your phones are locked up on the shelf, so I can make a show out of my... Lights go down, it's dark. The jungle is your head, can't rule your heart. I'm feeling so much stronger than a thought. Your eyes are widened, though your soul, it can't be bought. Your mind can wander. Hello, hello. Man, please go vertical. It's everything I wish I didn't know. You give me something I can feel. The night is full of holes, as bullets rip the sky of ink with gold. They sparkle as the boys play rock and roll. They know that they can't dance, at least they know. I can't stand the beats, asking for the check. Crimson nails got Jesus round her neck. Swing into the music, swing into the music. Oh, 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 oh. Ah, hello, hello. Well, please go vertical. It's everything I wish I didn't know. Would you give me something I can see? Gets hurt. Thank you. I was encouraged to go on tour with my book, Surrender. A lot of you know that when you two go on tour, it can involve some outsized props. Giant claw, we've had space stations, mirrorball lemons. Willie Williams has been told to cut back tonight, so I have a table and chairs. We adapt. And the otherworldly music of the Jackknife Lee Ensemble, featuring Kate Ellis on cellos and extraordinariness, and Gemma Doherty on the harp and other heavenly voices. It is preposterous to think that others might be as interested in your own story as you are. Writing a memoir is a whole other level of navel-gazing. But here we are. Turns out the most extraordinary thing about my life is the people I'm in relationship with, and I met most of them the same week. I began life with my wife, Ali. Same week I joined you two. Yeah. 1 week during high school and my whole life sorted. Sort of. When Ali and I married, we moved out of our family homes. That's how young we were. We moved into an old stone tower on the Irish coast. Spare us the furrowed brow of earnest young men reading and writing poetry. I read W.B. Yeats' The Tower, then we moved into one. If you'll indulge me, I could draw you a picture. The walls of the Martello Tower were made of granite and
7 feet thick. It was a fort containing 3 circular rooms, 2 bathrooms, and a kitchen built into the walls. The living room was like a granite igloo with an opening onto a solid stone winding staircase leading up to the lookout that we slept in, where we built a glass room from which we could look out over the promenade of the seaside town of Bray. It was a lighthouse. I know. Ali will let her soul be searched, but only if you arrive at her fort defenseless have you half a chance at challenging her own almost unbroachable defenses. It's the only way over that drawbridge. It wasn't 2 years into our marriage and I could see my wife in prolonged moments returning to the vast silence she holds inside herself. She was suggesting that even when I was home, I wasn't home. Our weekly walks along the promenade could be tinged with melancholy. There is anyway a kind of off-color romance to a deserted seaside town in the winter. Your heart's opera scored by the sound of the tide crashing over a stony beach, shushing everything as the waves try to make up their mind whether they're leaving or staying. Leaving or staying. White waves kissing black stones, shushing all around. That's the problem. It's a bit surreal though, isn't it? To fall in love with a stranger. Seems to be going well though. Yeah, thanks. I'd like to start my dog and pony show with a magic trick inspired by the great Tommy Cooper. It's gonna take a little concentration, okay? Okay, you got me? Watch this. Hello. Hello. Shh, 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 shh. No hands. Is that not? What? Show business and shamanism. Anyway, tonight I would like to try out some scenes from Surrender. Me book what I wrote myself. The next one's from the first chapter. A dramatic opening could have been a dramatic closing. You see, I was born with an eccentric heart. In one of the chambers of my heart, where most people have three doors, I have two. Two swinging doors, which at Christmas 2016 were coming off their hinges. The aorta is your main artery, your lifeline. My aorta, after years of stress, has developed a blister. A blister that's about to burst, which will put me in the next life faster than I can say goodbye to this one. So here I am in Mount Sinai Hospital, New York City. Looking down on myself from above, with the arc lights reflecting on the stainless steel counter. Hot blood is swirling, spilling, and making a mess, which is what blood does when it's not keeping you alive. Blood and air, blood and guts, blood and brains are what's required right now. The brains and the hands of the surgeon who is standing over me. This man is climbing up and onto my chest, wielding his blade with the combined forces of science and butchery. The force required to break and enter someone's heart. I'm in. After 8 hours of surgery, as well as flying, I'm drowning, desperately drawing for air, and I can't find any. I always thought my gift was to find the top line melody in a song, in a room, the hook, the clear thought that I had to sell or sing. Piece of my heart now, baby. I'm loving that oxycontin feeling, baby. Now I see that my gift was simply air. Air, that's all it was. Air. Air. Your man has a lot of firepower in that war chest of his. That's the voice of the man who sawed through my breastbone and is speaking to my wife and next of kin, Allie, after the operation. We needed extra strong wire to sew him up. He's probably at 130% of normal lung capacity for his age. Yeah. Air is stamina. Air is the confidence to take on big challenges. Air is not the will to conquer Everest, but the ability to endure the climb. And here I am without it for the first time, without air, without breath. The names we give God, all breath. Jehovah, Yeshua. I'm without air and I'm terrified because for the first time ever, I reach for Yeshua. And Yeshua is not there. God seems to have gone missing. But who guides the surgeon's hands, who sew my heart with thread, who brings these great physicians to circle my bed? Of science and the human heart, there is no limit. There is no failure here, sweetheart. Just when you quit, I am you and you are mine, and love makes nonsense of space and time will disappear. Love and logic keep us clear. Reason is on the side of love. Who wrote those lyrics? Who am I? Where am I? How did I get here? Without air, without a prayer, without an aria. An aria. How did I get here? Well, my father was a tenor. A really, really good one. I mean, he could move people with his singing, and to move people with music, I mean, you first have to be moved by it. I see my father standing in the living room of 10 Cedarwood Road in front of the stereo with two of my mother's knitting needles, conducting Beethoven, Mozart, Verdi. Right now, he's listening to La Traviata. His eyes are closed. He's lost. Lost in reverie. He's taken by the music. No longer present. He's not precisely aware of the story of La Traviata, but he feels it. A father and son at odds. Lovers cast away and returned. He senses the injustice of the human heart. His heart is broken by the music. I will spend most of my life trying to figure out the opera playing inside my father's head. He doesn't really notice much else. Least of all me, age 10, just looking up at him. Now, if you want your child to grow up and be a grandstanding stadium singer, there are a couple of ways to go about it. You can tell them they're gifted, that the world needs to hear their voice. This is the Italian method. Or you can completely ignore them. This can be the Irish method. Much more effective in my case. I craved my father's attention. I wanted him to think that I had music in me too. He didn't hear me. So I sang louder and louder. In fact, you could say I sang my way to right in front of you this evening. So, thanks, Dad. My father had some very good reasons for staying lost in his own world. I think we might need some harp music for this next bit. It's the tragic part. You know, the harp has been around for a long time. I mean, King David played the harp and it pleased the Lord. Well, Gemma Doherty plays the harp and it pleases me very much. My mother, Iris, died when I was 14. The last time I saw her alive was at her own father's funeral. This sounds too Irish, I know. But this is my story, I'm stuck with it. As my grandfather's casket was being lowered into the ground, my mother collapsed. I stood watching as my father and my older brother carried her to the car to drive her to the hospital where she passed away. She died of an aneurysm. It happens. I felt useless, so I prayed. My father's response to this tragedy was to never speak of her again. With Iris gone, our home at number 10 is becoming its own opera. I'm locked in a house where three men are living in rage and melancholy. A house where the name of our grief is never spoken. Iris, my mother's name is Iris. The house became a river of silence in which I might have drowned had my big brother Norman not thrown me a lifeline. He gave me a guitar, his guitar, a shield, a weapon, a confidant, another voice to pray with, music.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah.
Go, 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 Cuba. Let's see you go, 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 Cuba. Let's see you go, 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 Cuba.
Go. Go.
Let's see you go, 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 Cuba. Let's see you go, 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 Cuba. Let's see you go, 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 Cuba.
Go. Go. Oh. I am jumping around the living room of 10 Cedarwood Road to the sound of Glad to See You Go from the Ramones Leave Home album. These punk rock songs are so simple, and yet they capture how my life feels to me better than Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment, which I've just finished. Took me 3.5 weeks to read, but this album takes only 29 minutes and 57 seconds. Songs so simple that even I can play them on guitar, and I can't play guitar yet. Songs so simple that even I might be able to write one. It's May 10, 1978. Today is my 18th birthday. Don't do cakes. Instead, the dad wants to talk to me about getting a job. A job? A job is where you do something you don't really like for 8 hours a day, 5 or 6 days a week, in return for money to do the things you want to do all the time on the weekend. I know if I could do something I love, I would never have to work a day in my life. But to do that, you have to be great at something. And I'm not great at something. I'm not great at anything. I'm smart enough to know I'm not smart enough. The Ramones are smart enough to play dumb. Maybe I need to listen to even more Ramones. This is the day I'm gonna write my very first proper rock and roll song. It will become U2's first single. It will save my life. It is called Out of Control.
Morning, morning, 18 years of dawning. Say hello, say hello. It was one dull dawning, awoke the world with morning. I was so sad, they were so glad. I had a feeling it was out of control. I was off the opinion it was out of control. Oh, 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 oh. will not be mine. But it's never too late to pick a fight with fate. Oh, I had spirit and we had soul. Even then I was out of control. Oh. Let me tell you something about the geometry and the geography of the Irish mind. The Irish mind is best understood as being like an Irish pub. You go to forget, but in the end, you are drowning in memories and salt and vinegar crisps and black stuff. Finnegan's Pub is not just my local, it's its own country, with its own laws and customs. It is the domain of Dan Finnegan and his sons. It's a constitutional monarchy, with Dan head of state and his sons running the government. His eldest, Donal, the Prime Minister, or Taoiseach, is 6'4", and depending on the hour and the state of the state, can appear 6'7". I would not want to mess with Donal Finnegan, or his brothers, or his sisters. Finnegans are fine people, but there is a code, a strictness, a reverence for tradition, indeed, a respect for opera, and the kind of man who might know how to wear tweed, like my father, Bob. Now, within the nation of Finnegans is a small Italian consulate, the Sorrento Lounge, which is where on a Sunday I would meet my father for a drink, and we would sit there and not talk to each other. I would order a pint, which is always a Guinness in Dublin. He, the Catholic, would order a Blackbush, Bushmills being a Protestant whiskey from County Antrim. Already a subtle signal that Brendan Robert Hewson was his own man, and one with a great opening line, the same opening line every single time. Anything strange or startling? Now, by strange or startling, he was not interested in the riotous life of a rock and roll singer. He wanted to hear the latest news of his grandchildren or Ali or some work we might be doing on the house, but mostly we sat in silence. I try to impress him. How about the great Luciano Pavarotti calling the house? Do you consider that strange or startling? Startling? Well, that's obvious. Strange? Why would a great tenor be calling you? No offense. None taken. Actually, he's looking for a song. Oh, did he dial the wrong number? No, he wants me, with a little help from Edge, to write him a song. Not Gilbert and fucking Sullivan or Rodgers and Hammerding. Me, B-O-N-O, Paul. You. You. A baritone who thinks he's a tenor. Yeah, me. Pavarotti wants me to write him a song. Now who's the fucking idiot? He is.
seeks musicians to form band. How casually our destiny arrives. How did we get all the drums, the amps, and the apprentice rock stars into this tiny kitchen on that first Wednesday after school? It felt as if no one was in tune but Larry Mullen, who appeared quite at home around all this teenage chaos. Well, he was at home. It was his kitchen. Everything I still love about Larry's playing was present then. The primal power of the tom-toms, the snap and the slap of the snare drum as it bounced off windows and walls. This indoor thunder, I thought to myself, will bring the whole house down. Let me introduce you to Larry Mullen, Jr. Now, most people who enter a room with Larry Mullen find him striking in the sense that he is a stylish, good-looking member of the species, but also in the sense that he can be strikingly suspicious of why you are in his gaze, of your intentions, your being in the room, and perhaps on a bad day, your reason for being anywhere at all. But when Larry loves people, he loves them completely, and I am grateful to have become one of the beneficiaries of that love. When I met Larry, his favorite bands were Slade, T-Rex. His favorite artist was David Bowie. He couldn't stand jazz, that was all. But jazz was the reason Larry Mullen Sr. let Larry Mullen Jr. have a drum kit. So you could say that Larry became a rock star by pretending he didn't want to be one. I think Larry Mullen Jr. is kind of still playing that game. let me introduce you to David Evans. Come on. My first memory of him is a geometrical one. The angular face on this boy who would buy a guitar the same shape as his head. A cut jaw and a cone brain. Sometimes the name you're given at birth is just not your real name, is it? I mean, David Evans was always the edge, right? 1976, he was 15, a year younger than me. He was leaning up against the wall in Mount Temple Comprehensive, plucking a complicated guitar line from the progressive rock group, Yes. I thought, no. Though his hair was brushed forward, and I guess you'd say he was beginning to get cool. He was in class with Alison Stewart, my future wife, and it was said that they were the smartest in their year, that he had a crush on her, and that they might have gone for walks and stuff. I decided right then and there, I was gonna keep an eye on this guitar genius. My party piece, I'd been teaching Ali how to play George Harrison's Something on one guitar string. David Evans could play anything he wanted, which I feared might mean he could achieve anything he wanted. When Edge played guitar, he went into a kind of trance. He didn't know the name of the chords he was playing. He still doesn't, and still doesn't want to. He wasn't bluffing. That said, you could be sitting opposite the Edge at a poker table and never know if he had four aces or nothing at all. There's stuff you can learn from people who don't tell you anything. Now, let me introduce you to a proper rock and roll star, Adam Clayton. A true believer in rock and roll. Only one commandment: four strings are better than six. He had the style, the attitude, the ambition. Only problem was he couldn't play, which wasn't really a problem as I couldn't sing. He appeared to us for the first time swaggering through the gates of Mount Temple Comprehensive in an Afghan coat that looked like it contained a whole herd of sheep, in a Pakistan 76 t-shirt. To keep it real. And a wild, wild blonde afro, like a photo negative of Jimi Hendrix. What a vain, glorious sight. And what an opening line to impress this ashtray of a social experiment on the north side. Where might I find the smoking room? What? What are you smoking? I mean, he must have thought, you know, we were about to set fire to him. But actually, all we saw was our very own posh Sid Vicious. And strangely, our very own Malcolm McLaren, who is the manager of the Sex Pistols, because Adam Clayton was our first manager, the first person who believed the band could go all the way. And rare is a man so at home in his own body, equally celebrating or mocking all bodily functions, and particularly delighted with his own penis. Invited or not, you were never surprised to find him giving it some air. Adam could be nonchalantly relieving himself on the grass while discussing the Irish punk scene, specifically his favorite band, the Radiators from Space. The singer's name is Stephen Rapid, and he rapidly suggests that we change our name from The Hype to, wait for it, U2, a letter and a number. He says it'll look great on a t-shirt and big and bold on a poster. Proved to be the right name for our group. But to be honest, I still prefer The Hype. I think it's more accurate. There you are. This is our story. That isn't part of me. Like a radio with no controls. In my imagination, there's only static and flow. No yes or no. Your story is for boys. Stories for boys. Stories for boys. That's it. Thank you. U2's rehearsal room was a small cottage backing onto a graveyard in North County Dublin, same graveyard my mother was buried in. We called it the Yellow House. Today, not for the first time, I've been screaming and roaring at my bandmates. It's the usual old shite. They've been playing too fast, or too slow, or just not being there to catch me as I jump off some high building in my head. I mean, forget Ireland bursting into paramilitary flames. Oh no. On this day in the winter of 1978, the most pressing issue facing all of humanity is this band not being good enough musicians as if I was. I'm trying to explain to them how excited I am by the new Public Image Limited song. A great song, I explain, like I know, can be written on two strings over two chords. I'm trying to get the Edge to play the sound of an electric drill into your brain, a chainsaw through the carcass of the past. Edge is not following my invective. He's losing patience, and I'm becoming ever more invected. So invected that I grab his Gibson Explorer, which he bought in the same shape as his head, and wrap it around my own neck. And start making a dangerous squeal of the sound. Go on, says Edge. Keep it coming. You're nearly there. You like it? Not sure I like it, but it does sound like a dentist drill. Let me see if I can take it somewhere. In this ego-filled and ego-less moment, a song is forming. A song that will be called I Will Follow. If you walk away, walk away, walk away, walk away. It's a rhythm hook, like a wah-wah pedal. Walk away, walk away, walk away, walk away. I will follow. Edge is turning my graffiti into some fucking Raphael mother and child. And Larry and Adam, well, they're burning down the gallery. Larry, we can do this. Adam, let's do what we can do, the thing we can do that no one else can do. We have to find out what that is. Edge, Adam, Larry, if you walk away, walk away, walk away, walk away. Edge, Adam, Larry, if you walk away, walk away, I will follow. Oh, you're really good. No, you're really great. What's it about? We asked each other. I suggest that the song might be a suicide note. A young boy will find his lost love, even if he has to follow her into the grave. What no one in that rehearsal room, including me, had thought about was Iris Houston resting under the ground, not 100 yards from where we were playing. And all the time we rehearsed in the yellow house, I never thought about her. I never once visited her grave. It wasn't like she was dead. It was worse. We disappeared her. But Iris would not be denied. No, not in the music. Iris standing in the hall.
She tells me I can do,
she tells me I can do it all. Iris wakes,
to my
nightmares. Don't fear the world. It isn't there. Iris playing on the string.
Iris playing on the string.
She buries the boy.
She buries her boy
beneath the sand. Iris.
Iris
says that I will be
the death of her.
The death of her.
But it was not.
But it wasn't fucking me. Ha!
me go. Hold me close, like I'm someone that you might know.
I might have spent my whole life trying to fill the silence my mother left me. It's a lot of noise. More show business, eh? Back in the Sorrento Lounge, the usual opening line from the Da. Anything strange or startling? Everything strange and startling. Oh, you're right there. I took a taxi out here today. The driver saw where I was going and asked if I knew Bono. I said, I do not. Do you? Oh, yes, is he? Sure, we all know Bono out here. Sure, isn't he hounded by the Pavarotti? Hounded by the Pavarotti? I never heard that one. Paparazzi, is it? Funny you should say that. The great paparazzi himself has been calling the house again. This time he wants us to perform with him in his hometown of Modena. He wants to raise money for refugees from the war in Bosnia. I mean, how do you say no to that? For once, would you just do what you're told? I want to do what I'm told, but I'm also being told by the band to stop getting distracted so we can finish a U2 album rather than just one for Pavarotti, you know? Let me explain something about being in the band that even my dad doesn't understand. The popular perception is that I am the leader of U2. I wish. I voted that U2 should be an actual democracy, so now I'm in a band with three other people, each of whom thinks he is the leader of U2. My wanting to do something does not necessarily mean they are wanting to do something. Luciano Pavarotti does not grasp this. He thinks he just needs to get in a room with them and he can do to them what he did to me. Anyway, I was telling this story to the Da. Da! So, the whole band were in studio in Hanover Quay when the phone rang, you know? Ring, 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 ring. Hello?
Bono, Bono, Bono. How are you? Are you weary from the mountain top? Have you come down the mountain top with the tablets of rock and roll?
The new album, yeah, we're late as always. We're in the studio working every hour.
You told me this, and dearest Bono, that is why I am here to help.
I'm sorry, you're in Dublin?
I am this very minute in the Irish Customs and Exercise. I have told them I have nothing to declare but my love of Bono, Edge, James and Larry. It is my sole purpose in this moment to be of great service to these great men.
Oh, maestro. Oh, maestro, they are great men. And this is a great honor. It's just not a great moment.
They don't like me?
It's worse. They don't care. I mean, these are the children of punk rock. I mean, they'll expect you're only here to twist their arm into going to Modena.
Ah, This pains me. I came only in genuflection, and now you want to make me kneel and beg? No, maestro, it's not like that. Perfetto, I am on my way. Fuck. Oh, anyway, I go to Edge, Adam and Larry. I'm telling them, this is the greatest singer in the history of the world. It is a huge honor that he's coming to see us in less than an hour. In an hour, says Larry, he's not coming to see us. This is some kind of stunt, says Adam, and we will not be coerced. What are you going to do? I said to them, hide? No, we're not going to hide, says Edge. Actually, says Adam and Larry, that's exactly what we're going to do. We are going to hide. And with that, two grown men go and hide from Luciano Pavarotti. That's what happens. Next thing, buzzer rings. And there he stands. Oh my God. The greatest singer in the history of the world. With a film crew. 7 or 8 excited Italians, one of them is crying. Bono, bono, Edge, Edge, bono, bono. Where are James and Larry? These are my friends at the Rai Uno. We can go live on satellite television and announce the show in Modena to the whole world. In what corner of the universe is the great Pavarotti knocking on your door and you are not letting him in? Has the world gone bloody mad? In my corner of the universe, we very much let him in. Edge's corner too. We are off to be part of Pavarotti and friends in Modena to support Warchild. Adam and Larry are missing in action on this one, but would you like to go? Oh, really? Okay. I suppose you better have at least one real tenor on your side. Temple Comprehensive was a non-denominational, co-educational experiment in a country that was close to civil war along sectarian lines. We had Catholics and Protestants in the same class. You were encouraged to be yourself, to be creative, to wear your own clothes, and there were girls also wearing their own clothes. Ironically, amid this freedom from religion, we found ourselves getting religion. We got close to a group of Christian radicals called Shalom. They figured the established churches had not just gotten away from Jesus, but they had got in the way of Jesus. Theirs was a rigorous and demanding life that attracted some strange characters, so we fit in perfectly. As you two started to get popular, our first century Christians
saw the band's 20th century potential for advertising. Jingles for Jesus. We were not ready to be bumper stickers. We preferred the lyrics of St. Francis of Assisi. Preach the gospel and only use words if you absolutely have to. The Beatles were religious music to us. All You Need Is Love, that was our kind of billboard. Anyway, these beloved brethren began suggesting that our music was frivolous and self-flattering. In other words, fun. We asked the question, can we not change the world and have fun? No. You must choose between this world and the next. Eventually, it became too much for us. Particularly Edge, he couldn't live with the tension between being a disciple of Jesus and an apostle of Joey Ramone. Edge is not a complainer and doesn't do melodrama, but he was in some kind of agony. He eventually decided to leave the band. I felt conflicted too, and I'd no interest in carrying on in U2 without Edge. Larry sympathized with us both. Adam did not. Adam saw his whole life flashing behind him. One album and done, like the Sex Pistols, oh no. Then we had to go and tell our manager. Have I told you about Paul McGuinness? Oh yeah. McGuinness didn't just lead an insurrection in the music industry, he went to war for U2. The Winston Churchill of rock, eyebrows and all. That's right. Our battle for Britain was swiftly followed by our battle for everywhere else. He had just taken us once around the world. We really, really, really weren't looking forward to telling him we were breaking up his baby band just as they hit puberty. But he heard us out. There was some fidgeting, a pause, a slap of the face, his own, and then, am I to gather from this that you've been talking with God?
Yeah.
So you can just dial God up, huh?
Well, sort of.
And God wants you to leave your sinful life in rock and roll, yes?
We think it's God's will.
Well, maybe the next time you ring God, maybe you might ask him or her if it's okay for your representative on earth, i.e. me, to renege on a legal contract.
Beg your pardon?
Do you think God would have you break a legal contract, is my question. A contract I have signed on your behalf to go on tour. What sort of a God is that?
Good point. Paul McGuinness. Hell of a negotiator.
We, the negotiated, sheepishly back out of the room to have a little pray for better signal.
wasn't the first time we would put words in God's mouth, but the tour went ahead. And yes, it was blessed. And yes, there were miracles all around, like hearing, "I will follow" on the radio a lot. What a feeling that was. That was something. Oh, yes. What a feeling that was. Yeah. And when we came home, I was so high from everything I'd seen, everything I heard, like playing the Ritz for the first time just down the road. So ecstatic that I convinced my 21-year-old girlfriend to get married before the manager would send us out on tour again. Amazingly, she said yes. Ah. Oh. Where are we going? I'm not quite sure. Would you mind? No. You're very welcome on the bus. Edge was still not sure he wanted to be in a business of inflamed egos and pumped up personalities. I asked him, would he make an exception for me? Anyway, the question that was hanging over all our heads was very real. Can our music rise above itself and help right a world gone wrong? It's a lot to ask of a pop song. Our first album, Boy, had looked inwards. Our second album, October, had looked to the heavens. Now Edge began to wonder if maybe, just maybe, we could describe the actual world outside our window. But maybe our music could help real people in real situations with real problems. Maybe. Arpeggiating his way out of a corner, you could call it. He began working on a sketch of a song. Not just a song, a map. A way forward for you two and the world. Sunday Bloody Sunday was religious art meets the Clash. More pencil drawing than anything else, but its ambition was to contrast the original Easter Sunday with the massacre of 14 unarmed protesters in the city of Derry, just across the border on the island of Ireland. Now, while Edge was in his flat in Dublin, I was with my bride in Jamaica writing lyrics for the new songs, explaining to Ali why our honeymoon album was going to be called War. The honeymoon was a gift from Chris Blackwell, the founder of Island Records, the man who signed Bob Marley and the Wailers. Even now, when U2 plays Sunday Bloody Sunday, I still hear Bob Marley, and I will always hear Gemma Doherty, who hails from Derry. Whoa!
Tonight we can be as one. Tonight and tonight, broken bottles under children's feet, bodies strewn across a dead end street.
Around my neck. That's not just for show. I hold on to it tightly. I still need the Christ on the cross to get out of bed in the morning, is the truth. The nativity makes sense to me. You know? That there's a, I mean, if there's a great force of love and logic behind the universe, that it would describe itself as a child born in shit and straw poverty to a particular people in a particular moment in time, a great people, the people of the book, the Tanakh, the Torah, the Talmud, that such great force can describe itself as great vulnerability. I just still hold on to that. Right now, though, I'm working on some atonement with the dad. Oh, yeah. Later. I mean, everything was strange and startling. Edge and I did go to Modena, Italy, to perform with Luciano Pavarotti. We brought my father, Bob, and Edge's father, Garvin, also a tenor. Two tenors in search of a third, was the dad's line. But that wasn't the spectacle. The miracle of Modena was the transformation of Brendan Robert Hewson, my Irish Catholic father. Not by the great Italian Luciano Pavarotti, but by the woman on his arm, Diana, Princess of Wales. a bright light made even more blinding by some kind of inner radiance. For those of you who don't know, Edge's family were Welsh, so they were thrilled to meet the Princess of Wales. Edge dared me to ask the Da, so I did. Da, fancy meeting Lady Di? The Evans are wondering.
What? What's she doing here? She's bloody everywhere. I mean, why would I want to meet a member of the royal family? I mean, that's like asking me, do I want to meet the winner of the lotto? I got it. Just asking.
Next bit, you actually just couldn't make up. The Da is in our trailer, not eating from Pavarotti's deli tray of exotic Italian meats with names none of us can pronounce. And when he turns around, she's right there, approaching 6 foot in her heels, a vision in ivory. Diana approached the Da as if in slow motion. How do you do? The Da melted. The shock of a close encounter with a member of the British royal family quickly became a teenage crush. Oh, very well. Thank you for asking. Very, very pleased to meet you. 800 years of oppression disappearing in 8 seconds. I mean, if you've ever wondered about the usefulness of the British royal family, which I have, I would point to this incident. 8 centuries of oppression, one princess, and we're even. Get home, the Da is still talking about Princess Diana, but he's modulating. I must say, she does great things for charity. But it's not charity you're on about, isn't it? It's justice, right? I mean, you wouldn't need charity if the world was just, now would you? Is the son starting to make sense to the father? I wouldn't go that far. But I heard your song Pride on the radio and I may have felt some. It was our first number one. It was in New Zealand. But it was that song that got us an invitation to play at Live Aid. That's right. Bob Geldof said when he heard it, he could forgive me the mullet. Anyway, when you two walked on stage at Live Aid, we found ourselves looking out at a sea of white flags. It really felt like it was our audience, you know? With their white flags swelling in the wind, flags of surrender even then, and a generous spirit moving through the crowd. Your spirit felt like our punk prayers were coming of age, you know? Prayers yeast, actually. Because to be hungry is to be at war with yourself, is it not? To be at war with the very ground you walk on.
One man comes in the name of love. One man come and go. man comes here to justify, one man to overthrow, in the name of love. What more in the name of love? In the name of love. One more in the name of love. One man caught on a barbed wire fence, one man he resists, one boy washed up on an empty beach, one boy never will be killed. In the name of love. What more in the name of love? In the name of love. What more in the name of love?
Wembley Stadium, London. A thought is being broadcast all over the world. What if we were the world? What if we could feed the world? What else could be done in the name of love? I still ask that question, and I still want to know the answer to that question.
After Live Aid, I realized that if U2 was going to be writing big songs about big subjects, I needed a bigger brain, a software update. Rather than go back to school, I went to Africa with the missus. Africa, where all of us began. Ajuba. South Wallo, Ethiopia, autumn 1985. I remember a morning mist lifting from the land, revealing a proud people who have walked through the night to find anywhere hope was alive. The red earth of Ethiopia is parched. These rural people are struggling to survive without food and water. Their world has turned in on them. The very land they live off has refused them entry. There's a rhythm of resistance, but it's slowing. The father offers me his son. He says his son has stopped growing. His heart is broken. My heart is woken. Emperor Menelik's tomb is open. Buried in this ground are great riches, but a great famine has turned this great nation upside down. The same country is about to turn our tiny lives right side up. We'll never be the same again. We won't want to be. In this parched place, we learn lessons from a landscape, from a people that we can never forget. Poverty is not natural. It is man-made and can be overcome by the actions of women and men, most likely women. I wanna run, I wanna hide, I wanna tear down the walls that hold me inside. Show me a place high on a desert plain where the streets are not named. To feel sunlight on my face, but I need some shade and shelter. This waterless place, each desert rose is a prayer for rain. Where the streets of the man. For me and well, it's all relative, isn't it? It's ridiculous, but it was tricky for Ali and I to return from Ethiopia. I mean, a large part of us is still there. It's one of those formative experiences. After the Joshua Tree, you two were getting a bit famous, a bit mainstream. We're either going to be embarrassed about that or not. Fame is currency. And by the way, it was you that opened our checkings account on that level. So thank you. I mean, we wanted to use that currency to get more than a seat in a fancy restaurant, which is not to be sniffed at. Live Aid and its spin-offs raised $250 million. $250 million, $250 million. But African countries were paying that sum to you and me every week for old loans we shoved down their throat during the Cold War. I learned a big lesson from that. Injustice is often disguised as bad luck. Now, as frontman with U2, I use some of that front to get through some doors that many of my Ethiopian friends would find slammed in their faces. I joined some new bands, Jubilee 2000, Drop the Debt, The One Campaign, Red. Bands, in my mind, bands of actualists. I thought I made up the word until I found it in a dictionary. You know, people who actually get shit done, you know, rather than just stir it. These bands didn't make music, but we still had to get our ideas heard by the people who could make or break the lives of the poorest of the poor. These people are called the government, the World Bank, the IMF. Now, what actually got us through those oak panel doors and into such deep institutional pockets was the company we kept, the extraordinarily broad coalition of support we lined up, what President Clinton referred to at the time as a big tent. That's a big tent you got there, Bono.
I mean, you got Baptist preachers, public school teachers, firefighters, and newspaper writers. You got NASCAR dads, business school grads. You got red states, blue states, and a wide range of mental states. I mean, you're veto-proof, my friend. Veto-proof. Then George Bush rode in on a horse that he named Compassionate Conservatism. Thank you very much. Amen to that. Right on. The 42nd, 43rd, 44th, and 46th presidents of the United States. All thought that the world needed to know the size of America's heart. Me? I got to know more about politics than I ever wanted to know. I shook the hands of people I would normally arm wrestle. I had drinks with people I would normally pour a pint over. You could say I was learning to surrender something I didn't need for something I did. Knowledge of the opponent. Any boxer will tell you it's essential. But sometimes the best way to win over an opponent is to stop being one. I mean, really, the one campaign had just one idea. You don't have to agree with someone on everything if the one thing you do agree on is important enough. All right, Tom Hart? All right, Tom Preston? The question remained, would my actual band want to be in that big tent with the little singer if there was a big stink in the tent? Stinky people in their head. Anyway, the band held their noses and let me shred what was left of their cool. So I want to publicly thank my brothers here tonight. Thank you, Edge. Thank you, Adam. Thank you, Larry. In fact, They joined up for the fight against HIV. They signed up to join red. Red, the color of emergency. Red, the color of the blood that carries the virus that took 43 million lives. That's right. Now, red, as well as learning a lot from rock and roll, may have learned more from hip hop. Our friend Andre Harrell used to say, "You're in the getting the checks business. Did you get the checks?" Oh, hell yeah. Yes, we got the checks. One of my favorites was from Bank of America. Thank you, Brian Moynihan, signed it himself. Live Nation, yeah, lots of checks. Apple, lots of checks. What did they pay for, you might ask? Well, in a word, freedom. Freedom from despair, because it's hard to be free if you're dead. And America, for all the people who never get to thank you. Let me thank you. Let me thank you. And for my own freedom, too. Because you made our band from the north side of Dublin famous. You gave us a great life. Freedom is another word for that. Freedom and fun. A lot of fun. Maybe you can try to change the world and have fun. But get the check. Get the check. It's an Elvis move, baby. CCB, taking care of business. CCB, you have to check.
Lover, I'm off the streets. Gonna go to the bright lights. Big city. She's a candle.
She's the dollars. She's my protection. She's a promise in the year of election. Oh, sister, can't let you go. Like a preacher stealing hearts at a traveling show.
Tangle there. Okay. Hold on a sec. Let me put this down. Can I talk to you just about desire for a second? See, desire and virtue is a whole dance, right? And no one does it better than my missus. Desire went to number one in the charts. I don't know if there's a connection, but we were so excited we had our first baby. But if I'm honest, and I have tried to be in this tale I'm telling you tonight, I didn't know I could be a father. I didn't know if I'd know how to be a father because I didn't know how to be a son. I said in the beginning that Alison Stewart was going to save me from myself. Well, it's obvious that I'm curious about everything the world dangles in front of me, the temptations, as well as the opportunities. I would say Ali saved my life by seeing through me and seeing to me before I had anything, before I had my name. She knew what I had and what I had not. I've no shortage of people to disagree with me. In fact, I could do with a few sycophants if there's any of you out there. But when Ali tells me to grow up, but don't grow up completely, I want to understand what she means. She says, there's a boy in there with a bold face that I fell in love with. Don't lose him. For her, it's still Orpheus and Eurydice, still mischief and mystery. So, I'm still that boy. But I am more of a man because of this woman, and I am certainly a better father. One Sunday, in 1999, I'm back in the Sorrento Lounge with Da, and for the first time ever, I decide I'll ambush him with his own question, you know, just throw it at him, see what happens. Anything strange or startling, Da? I have cancer. I'm in the departure lounge, as it were. You won't be putting up with my unfunny jokes for much longer. Huge boulders fall on your head just like that from some imaginary mountain, you know. I thought I was getting to know him. I thought there'd be more time. I mean, how Bob Hewson of you, just when I thought I was finally getting to know you, that you might give me some answers, you give me the slip. Beaumont Hospital, Dublin, the summer of 2001. I see my father in a hospital bed and me sleeping beside him on a mattress on the floor. He's breathing, but it's getting shallower and shallower. Like, it feels like a grave in his chest. He shouts my name, confusing me with my brother or the other way around. Paul, Paul, Norman, Paul, Paul, Norman. Da? Da? I jump up and call a nurse. Are you okay, Bob? She whispers in his ear. His tenor has now become short, tinny breaths like an S after every exhalation. Yes, yes. What sounds like Parkinson's disease is he's just stolen his voice. I want to go home. I want to get out of here. Yes, yes. Say it again, Dad. Say it again, Dad. Like the nurse, I'm leaning over him, my ears close to his mouth. Silence. Followed by another silence. I lean in closer. Silence. Even closer. Fuck off! Fuck off. I mean, there is something perfectly imperfect about my dad's exit from my life. I don't believe he was telling me or the very vigilant night nurse to fuck off. I'd like to believe he was addressing the burdens that had been on his back for most of his life. I have a feeling they are my inheritance. But I believe I have a choice in the matter. Heart is bloom, shoots up through the stony ground. There's no room, no space to rent this town. You're out of luck, reason that you had to care. Traffic is stuck, you're not moving anywhere. You thought you'd found a friend to take you out of this place. Someone you could lend a hand in return for grace. It's a beautiful day. Sky falls, feel like a beautiful day. You're on the road, but you got no destination. Bones. The dead are always with us. There's more of them than us. the valley of dry bones, lust to dust, parched and abandoned, filled with doubt. After the flood, oh, those came out. All the colors came out. It was a beautiful day. So let it get away. Beautiful day. Yeah, yeah. Touch me now. Take me to that other place. Reach me. I know I'm not a hopeless case. What you don't have, you don't need it now. What you don't know, you can feel it somehow. What you don't have, you don't need it.
Is this working? Thank you. I have a very unscientific theory that sometimes when you lose someone you love, they bequeath you something, you know, a gift. When I lost my mother, I found you and the desire to sing for you. So when I lost my father, I found my voice started to change. I couldn't help thinking that the baritone who thought he was a tenor was actually becoming one. I don't know. All kinds of reasons for that might have something to do with this word forgiveness. I don't know if I forgave my father or my father forgave me. Clearly, I was born with my fists up. Surrender does not come easy to me. To bow down to my bandmates, to my wife, to my maker is a struggle, you know? It's a daily struggle that I'm still working on. But what I have learned since that Christmas, my heart was cracked open here in New York City. I learned that the silence is now filled with music and that I must surrender to the songs that sing me. And as to those questions about how to worship God, this is how I worship God. With you. With you. My father on earth, Brendan Robert Houston, gave me that. And with it, when he left, he left me with one of his favorite melodies to haunt me, I think. Because I only realized in the last couple of years that the title of this song he loved was the same name as our local watering hole, the Sorrento Lounge. The song's called Come Back to Sorrento. And I will.
Vide o mare, quante bello. spira tanto sentimento come tu e chi tiene a mente cascitato fai suonare. Guarda qua chi stu giardina sente si sciure arance nu profumo così fino dentro cuore se ne va e tu dici io parto ed io da lontane da stu cuore da sta terra dell'amore e nel cuore e non torna ma non me la sai.